Thank you and good morning. Thank you for the introduction. So today I'll try to give a brief overview or a bird's eye view on what we know and what we don't know on the impact of mainly R.O. brine on the coastal biota. And I would want to start with just a small and fairly easy definition as what is an impact or effect. I don't want you to think of it as good, in terms of good or bad, but rather as something that deviates from the natural or original state. That's what I would like you to think of throughout my presentation. So the current state that we have in Israel is basically, as people said, 5 megastructures producing around 600 million cubic meters of potable water a year, and releasing about that amount of brine back into the marine environment. The only big thing that we need to remember that it's on a coastal seashore of about 100 kilometers. I will give just 2 examples of the outfall criteria of 2 big facilities. One is the Sorek one that Yuval just showed, and it's really impressive. It's a diffuser system that sits out here in the ocean. The second system is Dome Ashkelon desalination facility, where you have a surface discharge of the desalinated brine together with the cooling systems of the power plant units. Now, just again, very, very small. The water density is governed by salinity and temperature. As water and more saline, they will sink. And if they're hot, they will rise. So we have 2 options as to diffuse the water back into the environment. One is termed positive buoyancy, and the other one is negative buoyancy. In Ashkelon, it is, from what I know, it is designed to have positive buoyancy. However, once some of the units in the power plant is not circulated inside or circulated inside with the brine, it tends sometimes to sink. In Panathinaikos Soek, as you've all said in the former presentation, we have a diffuser system that basically takes the brine farther from shore. One of the classes in this technology is that it can be we can avoid some stress to shallow organisms. In a dome desalination facility, as a case study, this was published again in Glaser in the annual report by Glaser 2015. You see in the spring a surface plume of around 1 kilometer. I must stress out that when I'm saying 1 kilometer, we're here at the color code around 2.5% or above background. Here you have the distance from the outfall itself. However, once you go to the bottom, and it should be buoyant and positively buoyant, however, once you go to the bottom, the plume is much larger. In this case, again, in the report, it says that just one unit was working, so that's maybe why it's a little bit farther from shore. But again, those are just data that you can all see. The max in this scenario, the max salinity units above background was 8.3%, right at the outfall, which is meters to tens of meters from the outfall itself. Now, after we think of brine, I'm asking, okay, what is in brine? And the first thing we see is, of course, salinity. So there's higher salinity. The higher salinity may cause osmotic stress, as Yuval just said before. And we have antiscalanes, which wasn't discussed before, but it comes today, in most cases, in the form of phosphonates that may cause eutrophication. Last thing, those coagulants, mainly ferric sulfate or ferric chloride, may again enhance the sedimentation in the aquatic environment as It can just make just static problems. I would not want to swim in a red room, but that's just me. Sorry? Yeah, well, I'm speaking here, so that's my point of view. What I won't discuss here, just because of time, but you can ask me in the end, is trace metals such as copper. Usually you will see them in multi-stage flashing, not really in RO, it's not a prevalent thing in RO. And I won't talk about so-called thermal pollution. When you look at the trophic level, you can define it in various ways. Just for this short and brief overview, I will talk about fish as basically swimmers. The plankton just rising with moving with the current. I will highlight the periplankton, phytoplankton. I won't talk on zooplankton this time just because of time constraints. I will also highlight some bentonic fauna or biota as benthic diphtheria and male fauna. And lastly, seagrass and macroalgae. I am aware that we don't have seagrass meadows currently in Israel. My main objective for you to remember is that I want to show you what are the short-term effects of our brine discharge on coastal organisms. And then we can discuss is there a fact or not. That's a whole different story. So I'll start with the swimmers. So in fish, we don't have a lot of data. That's one of the big, big problems. I'm not a fish person, and I could not find really literature on this topic. But what we can find is that basically sea bream juveniles start to die at 50 flounder larvae are in a similar range, and flounder eggs can survive up to 70 ppt, but will start to delay the development at around 50 ppt. Again, the main problem is that we just don't have data. As for avoidance, once you get to higher salinities, you start, or fish will start, again, I'm talking about salt, not temperature, the fish will start to go away from the outfall or from the high concentration by itself. However, once you're around the 40 ppt, you won't find really a big impact on those fish. When you're talking about mature fish, they did not find any or did not report any effect. Mature fish. However, again, I want to stress, I found very, very few reliable studies. Once you look on the next level, which I here define as plankton, phyto and periplankton, I will start with a field survey made by Drami et al. 11. And basically what they showed that there was a correlation between chlorophyll A as algae proxy. Here you see it on the y-axis, and on the x-axis you can see salinity. And there was an about 80% reduction with that salinity, but their pattern was not for that experiment. The next experiment that I found is a mesenchymal experiment made by Benkin et al. Just this year. And what you can see here is a relative change relative to the background and days with basically chlorophyll. The open circles are 5% above that. Above background, and black ones are 15%. And what was interesting is that you saw that there was a significant rise in chlorophyll biomass after 12 days with the increased salts. What they showed also is that there is a change in community structure, but I won't elaborate on the topic just because my next talk is by, fortunately, Natalia Belkin, and she will present all the rest of the data. As for the bacteria plankton, no significant change was reported in bacterial abundance or activity. When we go into the benthic, Again, it was hard to find reliable data on the topic. This is a paper in 2011 by Vieira. Most of the papers are coming from Spanish groups. This is from the Canary Islands, where you see abundance of megafauna. When I'm saying megafauna, this is just a token. You can go into the paper itself and look what happens to the individuals. But what I'm talking about are Mollusca, Crustacea, amphipods, and Polychaeta, and nematodes, which were the prevalent species here. At the outfall, 10% above background, there was a clear reduction relatively to farther from the background. However, it must be noted that the distance is between, again, this is in their paper, between 0 meters from the outfall to 30 meters of the outfall. So that's basically the area around it. When I looked into Glaser at 2013, and I have to say it's quite challenging. It's quite challenging going through those reports. The amount of data is overwhelming, and sometimes it's really hard to go by. However, here I tried to summarize it, at least for the megafauna. And what you see here is the station numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, just for now. And this is color coding, and I understand you cannot see the color coding here. But if you go into the paper itself, those are the organisms that were looked upon: Polychaeta, Crustacea, Nematode, and Mollusca. And here is basically the outfall. And this is the different stations. So here I'm just showing 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, which is 5 is right here. And you see, again, similarly to the paper before, a decrease as you go closer to the infall, to the outfall. However, I saw a couple of other trends that in that case, it was hard for me to, at least from reading it, it was hard for me to explain. However, there was, in the proximity of the outfall, there was a clear trend. What they also said in that report, that similarly to Becking et al., there was a community change in the outfall. So that's, again, something to consider. What we're doing currently, and that's one of our projects led by Hila, which is our master's student, is looking on the benthic microbial community. And the rationale behind it was that if any jet, any brine will end up to the floor, it may accumulate over time or increase in salinity inside the sediment. In order to do that, we made an array of cores. I won't get into the experimental setup just because I don't have time, because it wasn't like that. It was darkened just to make bacteria and so on and so forth. However, what we saw, and here on the y-axis you have bacterial abundance, and x-axis is different concentrations of brine just in the above the overlaying water. And what we saw is that up above 20% was a 60% reduction, which was highly significant. What you can also look, once you do those kinds of experiments, you can look on bacterial carbon demand, and that's actually the carbon that needs to sustain microbial community, since all of those are heterotrophs. And you can, and what you can see, which was quite similar to what Belkin et al. Saw, that was increase in the bacterial carbon demand. So the demand per core was higher. What you can also calculate is bacterial growth efficiency. It's basically the efficiency which these bacteria consume carbon and grow. And again, on the y-axis, you see BGE, bacterial growth efficiency in percentage relative to time. And again, you see an increase in BGE with salinity. What is ongoing currently is we're looking if there is a community shift. Currently, we don't know that. So this is currently unknown. But in the next few months, it will be money. The last thing, again, I acknowledge we don't have meadows in Israel, seagrass meadows in Israel, but a very, very significant impact is notable with seagrass. This is a paper by Garcia et al. 2007. We have numerous work on seagrass. This is just one. Here is the outfall. It's about 46 ppt, and this is basically the plume and meters from and distance from the plume. Once these seagrass encountered 40 to 46 ppt, they die. You don't see anything. This is basically stations across the outlet, and those are reference stations. This is a closer one. This is a farther one. So there was a very, very clear effect, primarily in photosynthesis and growth. So to summarize that, if we look at fish, talking about eggs, embryos, were damaged about above 8%. However, no effect was found for mature fish. If you look into phytoplankton or bacterial plankton in the field, again, drawing it at 2011, around 4%, there was a significant reduction in chlorophylla in phytoplankton. If you look at control mesocosms, around 15% resulted in increase in chlorophylla activity and a change in community composition. If you look at the benthos, when you're talking about bacteria, they definitely reduced abundance. However, it was above 20%, which is extremely high. And BCD and BGE increased as well. If you talk about male fauna, about 10%, you do see a significant change in numbers and in community. Finally, if you talk about seagrass, about 5% over the background, you have leaf necrosis and complete mortality once they encountered 50 ppt. Again, you saw a case study of 46 ppt, but when you look and compile around the 10 papers, this is roughly the number. My concluding remark is that short exposure to brine discharges, 5% over background of 50 ppt result in a clear impact on coastal biota. Again, impact, please remember, it's not bad or good. It's a change regarding the natural state. However, it is primarily on benthics or sessile organisms such as male fauna and seagrass. But I would like you to remember that these effects are between meters and up to a kilometer from the outfall. Here you see the change over the background in salinity. Here is the distance. And my take-home message, what I would like you to remember from my talk, is that the short-term effects of desalination brine discharge are local and typically apparent around the outflow. Again, this is based on just numbers. However, the chronic brine discharge might induce long-term effects, and that's very important to remember, on the coastal environment and must be regulated as an ecosystem and not as a singular species. Thus, I suggest, and that's my personal opinion, that it needs to be regulated and it needs to be continuously monitored. I would like to thank the Ministry of National Infrastructure, the Energy and Water Research for resources, and the Ministry of Environmental Protection, and thank you.